And last but not least, we have our seventh speaker, Carolina Marcos de Mesquita. Carolina is a 2019 graduate of Arizona State University, where she studied political science and English literature. She is a recent alumna of the Fulbright US Student Program in Portugal, where she served as an English teaching assistant at Politecnico de Leiria School of Education and Social Sciences. Carolina hopes to pursue a graduate degree in international relations and to study issues of peace building, gender, and migration on an international scale. Carolina, are you able to join us now? How are you? You were one of those Fulbrighters that had to leave the US before the end of your grant. So good to see you again.
Unfortunate end, but it was a great several months in Leiria, and so I'm happy to be speaking about it today.
Okay, so the floor is yours.
Awesome. Let's see. Okay, so can everyone see my screen? I believe that I'm sharing now. So good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, depending on where you are. My name is Carolina, and this last year I had the privilege of serving as an English teaching assistant with the Fulbright program in Leiria. For those of you that don't know, Leiria is a smallish town about an hour and a half north of Lisbon. I was placed at a polytechnic institute there, which was a really wonderful opportunity. Today, I'll be talking a little bit about a teaching project that I worked on while I was in Leiria, where working with the students, we essentially produced a series of independent podcast episodes, which was a lot of fun. And I think this is a really good kind of educational opportunity for English language learners. And I really want to talk about how these learners can become participants in creating new forms of media as opposed to just consuming media. Just to provide a little bit of context, I was placed at Instituto Politécnico de Leiria. It was interesting transitioning for me to working at a polytechnic institute, especially since I had such a kind of traditional humanities background, a lot of things like, you know, writing seminars or Socratic seminars. And I didn't necessarily know if that model would be totally helpful to students in a polytechnic institute, where often the focus is a little bit more pre-professional. I definitely wanted to kind of draw on my background with things like storytelling and and implement some of those ideas in the classroom, but I also really wanted to make sure that we were building skills that would lead students into successful careers depending on their degree program. I was primarily working with the Communication and Media Studies undergraduate program, so this is a three-year undergraduate program where at least 1 year of English study is required. Most of the students that I was working with were at a B2 plus level, so fairly high speaking level. I believe that it's classified as upper intermediate high. So these were students that were conversational, that were very comfortable speaking English, and the focus of the class was really on getting them to use English in academic or professional contexts, as opposed to just on a conversational level. So in thinking about some of the things that I would like for the students to do or to learn throughout the academic year, originally I thought that it would be fun, especially in speaking to so many of the students and learning that they were interested in journalism careers, I thought that it would originally be fun to put together something like a writing anthology of their work, having them report on local issues and interview locals. But I figured after thinking about it for a while that they were probably already doing a lot of that in their degree programs, or they would do that in the future. And I thought that, you know, being in the context of the Fulbright program in Leiria would be a fun opportunity to kind of try something a little bit new or something a little bit less traditional. So recognizing that they were probably already practicing their writing in English very frequently, I thought that it would be fun to practice something more close to audio production or audio journalism. I had a little bit of experience with independent podcasting in the past, and I thought that this would be a really fun kind of opportunity for them to practice multiple ways of learning English. So obviously speaking in English, writing and researching in English, interviewing other people in English. And so I began to introduce this idea to the class of creating independent podcasts together. So in order to prepare for creating our own podcast, originally what we did was we had a few close listening activities in the class. And this was a really great opportunity for them to also gain exposure to American culture. As far as I know, and speaking with the students, I asked them originally if any of them listened to podcasts. Podcasts are very popular in the United States. People listen to them. I listen to them when I'm doing the dishes or when I'm going for a walk. A lot of people listen to them on their morning commute or just have them in the background while they're in the house. And it seems like a lot of my students were listening to podcasts, but they were mostly listening to American podcasts or English language podcasts. And so I really wanted to encourage them with this project to think about podcasts as something not necessarily just being something that exists over there in some far distant country, but also something that could exist and that they could implement locally within their community. So to practice, we listened in class to two episodes, one of Criminal and one of This American Life, two very, very popular American podcasts. And as we were listening in class, I asked them to consider what makes an interesting audio story and what makes an interesting interview subject. So the podcast requirements were first to complete their podcast in groups of three. I assigned the groups, which was very unfortunate for them. They were a little bit salty about that. They were very mad at me for assigning the groups. But they also, I think, ended up collaborating really well in that context and getting to know each other in a really intimate way. Originally, a lot of these students didn't know each other. This was the first semester of their undergraduate program, and so this was a way for me to kind of try and have them build a community with each other, even with people outside of their immediate social circle. I asked them to create podcasts that were between 7 and 10 minutes long. One thing that I found working with the students that was really fortunate was that a lot of them went over that requirement. They ended up creating more content, which I was really proud of them for being so ambitious. They were also required to present at the end for a presentation grade. And then they were also required to complete one English language interview. This was a little bit of a challenge, certainly because not everyone that they might be interested in interviewing is an English language speaker. And so to get around that, I told them, okay, it's fine if you complete an interview in Portuguese, but when you include it in your podcast, you have to assume that the audience is English speaking. And so that will mean that you'll have to do a voiceover in English. So I figured that that would be a good alternative, so that if they couldn't practice interviewing in English, they could practice translating in English, which was kind of a way to get around some of those issues. And then again, you know, serving as a practice in speaking, writing, researching, and interviewing in English, building all of those competencies at once, as opposed to a project that might focus solely on writing or solely on oral presentation. So this is a slide from the original close listening activity that we did in class. I highly recommend this episode of Criminal if you have not heard it before. It was called Mrs. Sherlock Holmes. It was released last year. And it's essentially about a female detective living and working in New York in, I believe, the late 19th century. And it's about her journey solving a murder case within the Italian-American community of New York City and all the challenges that she faced as a female detective and all the ways that she tried to subvert some of those challenges throughout her career. So this podcast, Criminal, is generally focused on issues of criminal justice or, you know, historical crimes and the ways that they've influenced American life. But I really liked this episode because it also incorporated elements of social justice and an analysis of social inequality into the story by talking about issues of gender and the way that this female detective kind of diverted some of those issues in her career. And that was definitely something that I wanted the students to think about as they were developing their podcasts. I didn't want them to just necessarily report on, you know, some random interesting story in the context of Ladia. I also wanted them to draw some meaning from that. I think that podcasts are unique in that sense. You know, it's not just straight reporting where you're reporting the facts. There's also an element of narrative storytelling that I wanted them to incorporate. I wanted them to just keeping in mind that not everyone was at the same level. You know, we had some basic questions like, who are the main three characters of the story, to make sure that everyone is on the same page. I also asked them to identify what type of audio story this was. There are a lot of different types of podcasts. Some of them are just interviews between two people. Some of them are narratives. Some of them are almost like soap operas. And so I wanted them to think about the different kind of goals or intentions that a podcast could have, and whether a particular podcast was meant to inform or to entertain. Certainly in the context of this episode, I think the focus was to inform and to entertain at the same time, to inform about social issues within the criminal justice system, but then also to entertain by chronicling this very exciting murder mystery that happened in New York. So they had a really good time with this, and I remember I paused right before the big reveal of who the murderer was in the story, and they were so mad at me, and they all came back the next day and said that they had gone home and listened to the end of the podcast by themselves at home, and they were really happy to have been introduced to this very popular American podcast. So that was a really fun activity to be working with them on. After that, we started to prepare to produce our own podcast. And originally, I thought that it would be fine for them to record their podcasts using something like their iPhone. The iPhone microphone actually has very good audio quality, and so I figured that that would be no problem. But I ended up finding out during the first few weeks of my time in Leiria that the Polytechnic Institute had a recording studio that was mostly dormant. So it used to house the student broadcast radio station, I think in the early 2000s, but that radio station is no longer really in use. And so as a result, the studio was basically vacant for most of the time that we were there. And so I ended up reaching out to one of the staff members that worked in the studio to ask her if it would be possible for us to use the studio to record our podcast. And she was very excited. She said that she was really happy to see that it would be in use once again. And up to this point, I think that some of the students were a little bit skeptical shift. They became very, very excited to feel like they were, you know, in a professional recording context. Some of them talked to the staff member to see if they could come back and record things like music demos. They were really excited to be in this professional studio. And so I'll be sharing actually one of the podcasts that one of the groups produced. This was done by Tiago, Ofelia, and Chessie. And together they produced a podcast looking at cultural differences in the context of education, so the ways that different educational systems can reflect the cultural values of a particular country or region. This group, I remember, had a little bit of trouble in the beginning honing in on a project. They really seemed to want to make use of the international community that they were in. So at the time that I was teaching, a lot of the students that were in Leiria were international students from China, from Poland, from Ecuador, and they seemed to really want to rely on that international community to produce the podcast. But very frequently they would, you know, talk about cultural differences and how they wanted to produce an audio story about cultural differences. And I kept on asking them, what about cultural differences? Like, what do you want to say? What meaning do you want to draw from that? Can't you look at cultural differences through a specific lens? And I think that that's when it kind of clicked for them, and they realized that they would have the opportunity to be a little bit more specific in thinking about what cultural differences mean and how they come through in a particular context, in this case, in education. So I'm going to adjust the volume and then play.
Good morning and welcome to this episode's International Talk. Today we are going to talk about educational systems in different countries. I'm Ofelia.
I'm Tiago.
And I'm Chessie.
In China, we have a saying, 少年强则国强, which means that the prosperity of the country and the outstanding young generation is closely related with the rise and fall of the country.
I agree with that. As a matter of fact, nowadays, thanks to technology, we live in a more unified world and we deal with different perspectives almost every day.
Exactly. The means by which a person is raised helps build the future. The global village enhances our connection with each other, and therefore, how influent is our education in the outside world? Related to the topic, we interviewed three international students currently studying in Portugal and asked about their home country's educational systems. Here we have Sarah from Poland, who's been here for 4 months.
The educational system in your home country is representative of the culture and the image.
So I'm going to stop there just for the sake of time. But as you can see, they went above and beyond by interviewing not just one person, which was the requirement, but three people. And I had several students actually ask me, can we interview more than one person for this podcast? And every time I would say, yes, of course, we can interview as many people as you like. I just want to make sure that it's not too much work for you. And they were like, no, of course it's not. You know, we're super excited to be speaking with other people. One of the reasons that I required them to complete some type of interview was in order to have a primary research component to the podcast, but also to further embed themselves in the community. So as I mentioned, a lot of the students were international students. Most of the Portuguese students were also not from Leiria. They were from Braga, they were from Porto. And so I really wanted to encourage them to become involved in Leiria, in the academic community, and in the larger city by participating in these interviews. And I think they really rose to the challenge, which was really amazing. So just in thinking about some of the goals and the outcomes of this project, certainly what I wanted to do was build language competency in a fun or an innovative way. I have found often that when it comes to traditional presentations, sometimes English language learners can be a little bit hesitant because they have to improvise or they're not necessarily comfortable speaking with an accent in front of their peers. And so I wanted to encourage them to speak without maybe, or by maybe removing some of that element of improvisation, which I thought would be a good opportunity for them to practice in a different context, their speaking competency. I also wanted to build technical competencies and introduce them to digital journalism mediums. Again, one of the really fun parts about this was that so many of the students didn't necessarily have experience with podcasting, but I think certainly stepping into a studio, they could suddenly envision, you know, a future for themselves working in radio, or possibly using technology and social media to produce similar forms of journalism in the future, which was really great. Building a sense of civic engagement and community involvement was certainly something else that I wanted to encourage them to do. A lot of the students focused on international issues. There was another group that focused on studying abroad and the challenges of studying abroad by speaking with international students. There were two other groups that focused on the issue of intimate partner violence, which is a big issue in the context of Portugal. And I was really proud to see them tackle such a fraught subject and be so fearless and kind of investigating those issues. And then I also wanted to encourage them to think of themselves or to begin thinking of themselves as creators of popular media, not necessarily just consumers, and to get them to think about their future participating in creating these innovative mediums. So those were some of, I think, the really positive outcomes of this podcasting project. In the future, if anyone is interested on learning more about the intersection between podcasting and education, there was recently an interview with Maximilian Alvarez in the Chronicle of Higher Education, where he talks about the ways that these can intersect, the ways that podcasting can intersect with education. Here, I'll also plug in my own independent podcast with some shameless self-promotion. So I implemented a lot of the things that we discussed with the students in producing this other podcasting project, where I basically speak with Asian American leaders in my home state of Arizona about how they're working to advance a vision of inclusivity and community engagement across the Southwest, which I think is very important, certainly now in the context of COVID-19, where we see so much increased hostility toward Asian Americans. And as a member of the Asian American community myself, this was a really, has been a really, really fun project to be working on. So the link to the Spotify is there. And then finally, the focus of my project was not on this, or the focus of my presentation was not on this project, but I did want to mention one of the other really amazing opportunities that I had through Fulbright was to live in Leiria and to actually learn the story of Esteban Jiquidoys, who lived briefly in Leiria, as I'm sure a lot of you know. He wrote his first novel the crime of Padre Amaru in Leiria. One of the ironies of that is that Leiria continues to kind of glorify Yesa de Queiroz, and several of its monuments in the city kind of memorialize his presence there. But his book critical of Leiria. So he wrote the entire book being very, very critical of the social fabric of Leiria and small town life. And so I think that that irony was very, very interesting to me and something that I really had a lot of fun investigating. And it was ultimately published by Literary Hub just before the pandemic hit. So if you're interested in link to the in the slide as well. I am obviously so grateful to the Fulbright Commission for all of the support that they've provided in this very tumultuous time. I had an amazing few months in Leiria, and including photographs in my slideshow of Leiria that I took definitely made me very nostalgic for my time there. And so I definitely am already planning a return very soon. So hope you all stay safe. Thank you so much for tuning in. And that's about it for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Carolina. This is really interesting. A great initiative. As podcasts grow its popularity here in Portugal, it's amazing that you were able to do that. I do have a question from Sofia. Podcasts create communities and are an accessible medium, but aren't they also a means to
Yes, absolutely. So we did actually in class talk a lot about issues related to plagiarism, and also one of the things the students encountered very frequently was challenges in interviewing. So in particular, you know, how do you identify an interview subject who's an expert on their topic? How do you do effective research on a given topic? So we did do several workshops throughout the semester in preparation for completing this podcast. Issues of plagiarism and voyeurism, I would say, are also kind of characteristics of journalism in general. And so I also did ask a lot of the students to rely on their own backgrounds, taking other communication and media studies classes to address some of those issues. But we definitely, in private and also in the class, in the context of the classroom, addressed some of these issues as they came up. I was also monitoring pretty closely who the students were interviewing, what type of research they were doing, because I did want to make sure that they were on the right track. And I also drew upon my own background working in student journalism to respond to some of those issues. But mostly we responded to those on a need or case-by-case basis. So whenever the students had any particular questions or any particular concerns, I met with them individually and privately, especially if the topic was a very fraught issue, as, for example, the podcast about intimate partner violence. Very, very emotional, very sensitive topic. And so I worked with them very closely to make sure that the research that they produced was sound, that the people that they were interviewing were experts in the topic, or if they were not, that that was communicated to the audience in an effective way. So I definitely see that, and I tried to respond to that in the context of the assignment as best as I could.
Thank you. I have two more questions, and then we'll have to wrap up. From Elaine Avila. Hello, Elaine, how are you? What were some of the main differences you observed between American and Portuguese education / students? And I'll ask the second one, if it's okay. The initiative of using podcasting in Leiria had continuity with the other professors, or when you left, did it terminate it, or did it continue? So,
So I'll answer the second one first. So this was actually just done in the first semester of classes. And so I did not plan on continuing this project beyond that, but my mentor in Leiria, who teaches there, has taught there for over 20 years, has said that he thinks about implementing it with the next year's cohort as well. In the spring, my plan was to have the students work on a photojournalism project, so using another medium, but that did unfortunately get kind of swept to the side after the pandemic. And so that was, but hopefully they were able to absorb as much as possible from, you know, our time together with the podcasting project. I would say that one of the biggest differences that I observed between American and Portuguese students It's difficult to say. I think what was interesting was that because I was so close in age to the students, it didn't necessarily feel like a typical professor-student relationship. So, you know, in class, when I was a student, I always called my professors doctor so and such, you know, and I was always very formal. And there was a little bit of, I think, distance between me and my professors traditionally. But a lot of these students, you know, they just called me Carolina. You know, they would just send me emails that said, hey, professor, hey, teacher. You know, I had coffees with them. One of my fondest memories is of the first week that I was in Leidia. I had a student come up to me at the end of class, and he said, you know, is it possible that I can interview you over a coffee? You're the first American that I've ever met, and I would love to learn more about your country and where you come from. And we sat down at the cafe later that day, and he pulls out this notebook, and it has 3 pages front and back scrawled with questions to ask me about the United States. And so we start talking, and the first question that he asked me is, okay, can you explain to me the judicial system in the United States of America? And I was like, all right, we're going to be here for a while. And so that was a really, I think, fond memory that I have. And I would say that that characterized most of my relationships, not only with the Portuguese students, but with the large number of international students that I was working with as well. So that was certainly a lot of fun, and I'll definitely hold those memories very close to my heart.
Thank you so much. Now ask those attending the Zoom conference, if there's any further questions to Carolina or to any of the speakers. A few speakers had to leave early, but we still have Beatriz Albuquerque, Flávio Azevedo, Claudia Meca with us. So if there's any question for those speakers, we still have a couple of minutes to go through those questions. If not, okay. Professor Elsa, would you like to say something as a close?
I have one more question to Carolina. Okay. What happened? You have a great initiative at Polytechnic Leiria in English class with your students. What happened at the end of the semester? You went back to the United States. I imagine that that class is going to be provided by another professor, maybe a professor from Polytechnic Leiria, I don't know. That kind of initiative of teaching English and increasing the English using podcastings and technology applied to journalism, did it continue? Or the facilities, the infrastructure that was there, but was not in use, and stopped, and the English language continue being taught in the traditional way, I would say.
Yes, I'm not necessarily sure about my mentor's plans for English teaching for the next cohort. So I was working closely with a mentor who's a long-time professor at the Polytechnic Institute of Leiria, and I believe that he expressed interest in continuing this project in the future, but for the most part I envisioned this as just being one project that we worked on within the course of the semester, not necessarily like an ongoing extracurricular project. I would love to have the students continue it if it's interesting to them. That was not necessarily the way that I envisioned it in the future, but certainly I think after seeing the students so excited about some of the possibilities associated with podcasting and audio journalism, a lot of them expressed interest in returning to using those facilities. The recording studio, I think, is used on a sporadic basis. I think that now, for the most part, students use it for individual projects, but it's not necessarily in use at the same rate as it was originally when it was used for radio broadcasts. And so I would love to encourage the students to continue using it either for podcasting or for other projects. I do believe also that as the students accelerate in their degrees and they become students in the Communication and Media Studies program in their second or third years, there's production, I think, for them to using alternative mediums in the context of journalism and English language learning.
Thank you, Carolina.